Michael, I want to give you a warm welcome and a short presentation of you. I think most of us know who you are, but I will do that anyhow. Michael is an urbanist, architectural theorist, urban philosopher, researcher, educator, and executive director of Sustasis Foundation, based in Portland, Oregon. Michael is also senior research associate at Kungliga Tekniska Högskolan and director of the Future of Places Research Network in Stockholm. The Future of Places Forum has contributed to the new urban agenda and to the United Nations Habitat Global Public Space Toolkit. And Michael has served as consultant to the Secretary General of Habitat 3. And now the focus is on implementation and the need to share practical knowledge and research into action. So Michael, it's a pleasure to welcome you, giving a speech titled "The Empire's New Clothes: How Architecture is Still Failing Humanity."
Thank you very much. I am going to talk about a particular challenge that we have that I know you have been working on, and it's a very important one, which is this sort of obstacle of what you might call architecture, buildings that are not supportive of human well-being and quality of life. And I'm going to try to dig down into that. What are the causes of that? What are the forces of that? What are the things we can do about that for effective professional and cultural reforms? This is, by the way, where I am right now. This is the Columbia Gorge between Oregon and Washington. It's a very beautiful natural area, also a very beautiful area of architecture, as many parts of the United States are. You know, you think of the United States as a lot of sprawl and sort of modern buildings and so on, but there are many places that have very, very beautiful architecture up to about 1920 or so, which is a common story around the world. And I'll begin to unpack why that has happened and what that means for us today in particular. As was mentioned, I'm working at KTH with Peter Elmlin and others. We've been working with you and Habitat on the new urban agenda, which is I'm going to talk a little bit about what is in it and why I think it matters and has a connection to this issue of architecture and the people that we've been engaging with in many different disciplines, many different organizations around the world, as well as in Sweden. So just my own bona fides, if you will, I do have a PhD in architecture. I've studied philosophy as well as architecture and urban planning in a number of institutions. I have currently have had research or teaching appointments in 7 graduate institutions in 6 countries, and so on and so forth. So I'm not an outsider. I'm an insider who can sort of confess to you some of the insider problems that we face from a long career in the field and a lot of writing and research and publication as well. And I think it's fair to say that architecture and urban design are being challenged today to adopt a new and more human-focused paradigm. That's really what the new urban agenda is all about. That's been adopted by acclamation by all 193 member countries. So that's a big deal. And related also to the sustainable development goals, goal 11 about cities, which is very important. To summarize some of the key aspects, there's a greater focus on human health and well-being, a focus on sustainability, not just the green technology, but also more ecological ways of living, building capacity and capability. And as the economist Amartya Sen has described, self-directed pursuit of well-being by people and by communities, focus on opportunity for equitable human development and flourishing, you know, moving beyond the old GDP model, the old industrial model of growth. And so for architecture, I think that also means a greater focus on the architecture and urbanism of human life and of human connections, not just the world of designed objects and technological constructions. And as Peter likes to say, shifting from objects to places, which I think is very central to everything we're talking about here. So I want to ask, what does this mean for the future of architecture and the future of architectural education? Well, first of all, it's certainly a challenge to the current business as usual model, the old model of, if you will, art supplies to commodify these industrial products, these industrial structures. The architects come along and they provide some razzle dazzle and some packaging and some branding and theming in the name of, you know, fine art and the allure of great universities and so on. But that, I think many people have commented on, is a kind of corruption actually that's going on. That is, in effect, using architects and using their art to produce something that may or may not be promoting of human well-being. And as we'll see, it's certainly not. And it's a very old-fashioned model. It goes back almost a century now to Le Corbusier. Here he's 1924, describing the world that is very much like the world we see today all over the world. And yet in the intervening century, we've had fantastic new insights that have emerged from the sciences. We've understood a lot more about so-called fractals and attractors, genetic processes, self-organization processes, where biological forms create their own organizational patterns and build on their patterns and through the growth of evolutionary complexity. And in the world of design, that translates into many new tools and strategies using neuroscience, for example, environmental psychology, anthropology, mathematics, and many other fields. You've heard about evidence-based design, probably post-occupancy evaluations, so-called biophilic design, new ways of coding urban environments, zoning codes and design codes and so on, new models and standards. And I'm going to talk a little more also about pattern languages and wikis a little later, and new ways of thinking about design as a process really of transformation of our existing world, not the creation of newness for its own sake, new product, new images, of working with evolutionary history, ecology, and culture. So this, I think, is the new paradigm in many ways, and the new paradigm that architecture has not fully grasped at this point, if it has even begun to grasp it. And so you'll see language in the new urban agenda about renewal, regeneration, retrofitting, cultural heritage, both tangible and intangible, traditional knowledge, strengthening social participation, supporting the leveraging of cultural heritage, sustainable urban development, engaging indigenous peoples and local communities, protection of traditional expressions and languages, and using new technologies to do that, not to erase or to displace traditional expressions and languages, but to find new forms of expression, new forms of protection, really, of those expressions and languages. This is a very, very important idea, I think. And there is still a central place for expressive art and form, certainly, but its role is not to supplant human life with abstract sculptures and turning the city into a sculpture garden, but to enrich life, to illuminate and to enliven life. These are works by my friend Christopher Alexander, a wonderful market there in Fresno in the middle. And these technologies are not just one more sort of razzle-dazzle, wild, exuberant forms, as Charles Jenks, the theorist, argued in the jumping universe and new science, new architecture. We brought him together with some complexity scientists some years ago, and they gave him a very polite but firm criticism of this idea that it's just this more superficial stuff to package commodified industrial products. It's really a more radical agenda than that. And now, especially in the era of COVID, we are coming to terms with what this all means in terms of the interconnections of human life and the ways that we connect with each other, the ways that we stay protected from one another in the pandemic. So, for example, in the building on the upper left, the elevator lobbies and the stairwells and the central entrances, those bring us into close contact and allow transmission. They make us vulnerable to disease, whereas the more dispersed forms can allow us to stay protected at the same time that we're able to still interconnect with one another. And these are all exactly the same density, by the way. So it's not about density alone. It's about the pattern of connectivity. And that's a very, very important idea, I think. And it's important that we can have ways of being together and still protecting ourselves, what I like to refer to as sociable distancing. That's my daughter and grandkids there on their front porch of their home. And they can stay connected to people in the public realm on the sidewalk and still be safe. And this is a very important idea as well. So many critical thinkers have helped to define this new agenda that I argue is emerging. as our research and others has shown. I mentioned Christopher Alexander, the great Jane Jacobs, Kevin Lynch, many others. But we still have a major problem, as I alluded to in the title, The Emperor's New Clothes or The Empire's New Clothes, a proliferation of bad projects all over the world. If anything, an acceleration of them, as you were all were noting earlier, and a profession that stubbornly denies its own flaws in many cases, doubles down on many of its older mistakes, maybe because it literally can't see them. And there's very interesting work in social psychology and other fields of psychology that describe this, environmental psychology, research that shows that architects literally cannot see what non-architects see in the environment. And that this is creating a problem, because if architects have a job to make environments that other people find beneficial and desirable, then clearly they're going to have a problem doing that if they literally cannot see. And this is what my friend Nikos and I refer to as architectural myopia, the idea that these attention-getting features displace the aesthetic characteristics that are so important to most people, and often the practical concerns as well. And this is also related to something that Nikos and I refer to as geometrical fundamentalism, the obsession with the purity of forms, with the abstract form held in the mind as a sort of lovely idea that is very parochial, very private to me and to my friends. And you, a member of the public, might not be able to share that because you're not in on our predilections and preferences. Jonathan Swift's great story of Gulliver's Travels, the Laputans who are trapped in a sort of idealistic view of the world and can't see the practicalities. And this idea that art, it does play an important role, but if we allow it to lead and to displace our understanding of the human factors, then we can make terrible mistakes with this art-led approach, turning the city into a giant sculpture gallery, as you can see in many examples today, unfortunately. And even some architects themselves recognize this problem, recognize the corruption and the failings of architecture. Rem Koolhaas, for example, who's one of the most famous architects today, talks about modernism's alchemistic promise to transform quantity into quality through abstraction and repetition. It has been a failure, a hoax, a magic that didn't work, he says. And he talks about this collective shame in the wake of this fiasco that has left a massive crater in our understanding of modernity and modernization. And I think those are very true observations on his part. Absolutely, he's got his finger on the issue. And Peter Eisenman, his colleague, who actually was his mentor for many years, talking about the late period of modernism, the Rococo phase of modern architecture in its death rattle, but we can't figure out what comes next. We're sort of trapped in this twilight era, and we're making these ever more crazy, exuberant buildings. And we all know there's something wrong with them, but we can't really figure out what should come next. And Koolhaas goes on, and I won't go through all of this in detail, but just talking about how the market economy happened and allowed us to displace our, he says, our ideology. I think ideology also had something to do with it initially, at least, and to simply be extravagant and spectacular, to question our sincerity and motives. Because the work we do, he says, is no longer mutually reinforcing. Any accumulation is counterproductive to the point that each new addition reduces the sum's value. So I might make a single piece of sculpture that's quite interesting and wonderful in its own sort of parochial way, but then you put that next to another one and another one and another one, and you get this jumble, which is, this is actually Koolhaas's own composite image. And he shows it at his lectures, and everyone laughs at how ridiculous it is that each new addition reduces the sum's value. This is what we're doing to cities. We are degrading the wholeness, you know, the coherence of the city. And yet, Koolhaas is talking about this, and yet that is his building. So in a way, he's sort of having his cake and eating it too. One could say quite cynically so. He's talking about this massive crater in our understanding of modernity and modernization. And yet he seems content to just sort of play around in the bottom of the crater with the bits of rubble and see what kinds of interesting shapes he can produce. And I think, again, that's quite cynical. I think we can question his sincerity and motives as a result of that. So in the next part of the talk, let's go back to the beginning of this modern period of the early 20th century and try to understand, especially around 1920, a very fateful moment in history where you had many different forms of architectural expression, not only in the Western countries, but around the world, rich diversity of Art Deco, modern arts and crafts, Art Nouveau, eclectic Beaux-Arts. You all know Swedish Grace, of course, Vienna Secession, many, many, many different forms of expression. But guess what happened? No, we cannot do that. We have to stop. We have to start again from zero. This was Gropius's famous expression, Walter Gropius, the pioneer of the Bauhaus and of the modern trio who were the most influential along with Mies and Le Corbusier. And so here's Le Corbusier's work to erase a huge part of Paris and replace it with his new buildings for an automobile company. And here he is erasing a big part of Africa, a city in Algeria, Algiers, and replacing it with a Western model of purity and supremacy, really, cultural supremacy. And this is what's been going on around the world ever since, right? The sort of internationalization, the international style, and again, going on right in Dubai and Abu Dhabi and other places where you're taking these very harsh climatic conditions in the desert, you're putting buildings facing right into the sun, because they're just like buildings from any other part of the world, a very homogenized, globalized architectural system that is clearly problematic on many, many levels. What is the root of that, though, is this break in the way that we thought about history and modernity, that modernity is not a sort of evolutionary stage of history, it's a break from history. And you can see that very clearly in Le Corbusier, in the Athens Charter document that he wrote. He claimed it was emerged from the CIEM conference, but there's evidence that he actually wrote it himself. And one of the sections talks about using styles of the past must not be allowed, will not be tolerated in any form. It has harmful consequences. Never has a return to the past been recorded. Never has man retraced his own steps. Now, this is a very fanatical statement by a guy who was a collaborator with the Vichy Nazis and clearly had that kind of totalitarian streak in his personality. And it certainly comes through in a lot of his architecture. I don't understand for the life of me why he is revered today by many contemporary architects. If they knew a little more, perhaps they would reconsider. But never has man retraced his steps. Never has a return to the past been recorded. This is the sheerest nonsense for any historian who recognizes that history is a fugue, that things come and go and then come back again, that Jefferson recapitulated Rennes, recapitulated Palladio, recapitulated Vitruvius, and so on and so forth. And these are like 1700 years apart from one another. So things come, they go, they come, and so on. There's a fugue of things that work, things that are successful from an evolutionary point of view. And they, of course, produce many of the most beloved and sustaining places in human history, certainly in Western history. If you look at London, Paris, Rome, and so on. And this is true of the natural world as well. If you think about the dorsal fin of a porpoise, for example, the porpoise doesn't say, oh, no, I can't retrace the steps of evolutionary history. I can't go back to the shark and recapitulate the dorsal fin, even though it's a very successful evolutionary design and a wonderful adaptation. No, I'm modern. I can't do that. That's the most ridiculous thing in the world you can imagine. And this is 240 million years that evolution has retraced its steps, with apologies to Le Corbusier. So this is the sheerest nonsense from a scientific point of view. Science is all about understanding how patterns evolve and transform and regenerate and recapitulate from DNA, from structures that are embedded into the natural systems, the attractors, as they're sometimes called, and so forth, and how these patterns evolve over time. And so we are still in the grip of a very outmoded, old-fashioned, ironically enough, model of design that is all about technology as salvation, the romance of the new, the triumph of reason, political enlightenment, and so on and so forth. And it's mechanical technology as the ordering idea or the fashion or the image. It is purely an image, and it's an outmoded and laughable one in many ways. And yet, here we are. But to be fair to the people in the early 20th century, they had a rationale for thinking this way because they thought that cities had become terribly unhealthy places. We all recognize in the 19th century the problems, and people like Ebenezer Howard, who wanted to leave the city for the most part, or at least leave it to industrial activities and relocate the homes and the other activities out in separate areas, a place for everything and everything in its place. So you're going to segregate the parts of the city, pull them all apart. And the idea of rational segregation was very much in Le Corbusier's thinking, separate the buildings from the street, separate the pedestrians from the vehicles, and so on and so forth. And this was, again, the model that Le Corbusier promoted that is still very much the model all around the world to this very day, and very much a problematic model in many ways, as we understand. Because when we rationally segregate these urban elements and we create the capsule of the home and the capsule of the workplace, and we only connect them with the capsule of the car or the vehicle, there is no public space. There is no public interaction. There's no fabric of connections between people. And what you see, for example, in this drawing by Adolf Beyer in 1948, on the left is this purified world of everything separated out, segregated, but very, very little public space. But that was supposed to replace this messy, chaotic world on the right of, you know, disease and crowding and so on. But something very, very important was lost: the mixing, the interconnection, the life, really, of those public spaces and the way people interacted with each other. So this model of functional segregation was promoted heavily, and that was understandable at the time, a time of great optimism about the powers of mechanization and modernity. And that was what we've used to shape the world and still shape the world. The reason that we have a sustainability crisis in many ways, because we have profoundly changed how the city works and how its residents consume resources by spreading everything out and by requiring much more energy, many more resources to do everyday activities and so on. And we can also question this idea of functionalism. Is it really functionalism? As I showed in a recent paper, if you look at Le Corbusier's functionalism, it was really just an image. So, for example, the functionalism of a grain elevator was the model for new buildings. But human beings are not grains of wheat, right? Human beings have very different needs than grains of wheat. And the idea that buildings should use portholes and pipe railings like a ship. Well, the building doesn't go whooshing down the street and have to resist the crashing waves and so on. So this is a functionalism of image only. It's not a genuine functionalism. And if we're more authentic about thinking about design, we understand that it's a transformation, as Herbert Simon said, from existing states to preferred ones. It's not just an image. It's looking at the world we live in and trying to understand how we can live in a better world and what are the connections and the attributes that we prefer. And the great Jane Jacobs said that we needed to understand this kind of problem that a city is, or the kind of problem that a building is, or the human environment is, which she called organized complexity. It has many, many different connections, many different patterns of self-organization and interconnection and evolutionary form and growth and so on. And design is just one part of that, conscious design, but it needs to sort of engage with all these other processes that are going on. And so it's a process of adaptation, of building on successes, of reusing what works. Again, this is my friend Christopher Alexander's work there, and of understanding what Stephen Wolfram calls a new kind of science that understands how forms are generated through algorithms and through patterns, simple rules that generate complex forms. Like, you may have heard of this term, cellular automata, like the way bird flocks work, for example. A bird can be very simple in the way he behaves, but because of the way all the birds behave, they create an interactive self-organizing pattern that's very complex. And this is what happens, we now understand, in genetic processes, in the way forms grow and evolve in the world of evolution, for example, which is what creates the astonishing variety and also the astonishing beauty of the natural world, because it gives rise to these forms of complexity and symmetry and so on. And I'll try to save some time to talk about symmetry as well. It's an important topic. But this idea that there are interconnections between the elements of a design, as Herbert Simon referred to it, nearly decomposable hierarchies. They're not perfectly decomposable rational schemes. There are these interconnections that Christopher Alexander later called overlap and semi-lattice. And he wrote a paper, A City Is Not a Tree, described how that happens in a city. And this is not a simpler version of urban structure, but actually a thicker, tougher, more subtle, and more complex view of structure, the idea of networks, the idea of interconnected web networks, like the world that we live in today in many ways, and the idea that the sidewalk is a web network of human connections and human opportunities and the opportunity to meet new people and exchange new ideas and to just experience the life of other people in other communities, so very important, as Jane Jacobs pointed out. So I think we're coming around to a new understanding of the city as a kind of contact system, as a set of interactions and flows, as our friend Mike Batty and Peter Ferguson said. And this is how innovation happens, how cities give us what they give us in terms of the creativity and the expansion of knowledge, expansion of wealth even. And this is also where equity comes in, as a friend Luis Betancourt has pointed out, because if you disconnect parts of the city because of poverty or because of other problems, whatever they are, you're going to create problems for the city as a whole. It will underperform relative to cities that are more interconnected, more successfully connected, and have more opportunities for everybody. And that's a principle known as Metcalfe's law. The more connections of nodes you have, the more robust the network, the more productive it is. And so this is a central theme of our work at the center, the importance of these spatial frameworks, public space frameworks, to connect us and to create economic spillovers and life chances and opportunities for development and so on. And this idea of the city as a contact system, as I said before. So we're learning a lot from network theory, for example, understanding how these systems of connections function, economic networks, technological networks, ecological networks, urban networks, and so on. We're learning a lot from how that applies to cities and economic expansion and exchange and creativity and so on. We're learning from anthropology and sociology, how people behave in public space and around each other in behavior settings and so on, and how the private edges shape the activities that people have in public spaces. This is very important for practice. We're learning a lot from mathematics and from game theory, from how people behave in relatively simple rule-based patterns that create very complex results. And this is what goes on in cities, for example, and from evolutionary morphology, how cities grow and change over time, very much like natural structures do as well. We're learning a lot from cognitive and environmental and social psychology, how we respond to our environments, how evolutionary history has adapted us well to be around natural environments, to love natural environments, biophilia, water, vegetation, and so on, why these are so important to us. And also the properties of vegetation on the buildings themselves, not just, you know, shrubbing it up, but actually within the building, these fractal patterns and so on. So let's back up for a minute here and ask the question, why do we build cities at all? What is it that we're doing when we build cities? Why don't we just live as we did for many thousands of years as hunter-gatherers or, you know, in dispersed locations? Well, clearly the city brings us together to create a life, a livelihood, a culture, a polis. But in so doing, we constrain each other's freedom to participate in that life. And we constrain the freedom of others. A wall that I build is going to limit your freedom to enter the other side, of course. And so the structure of public and private space forms this kind of physical counterpart to this political and legal system of public and private, that I have this private realm, it's my house, you can't come into it unless I let you in, and so on. But there's a whole range of spaces in between that, and that's a mediation between conflicting freedoms, as our friend Paul Moraine puts it. So urbanism, architecture too, manifests this mediation between conflicting freedoms of the people who are interacting within the city. So that sounds a little bit abstract, I know, but let me give you a more concrete example. So there's your home and there's my home, and we're close to each other, and your freedom to party until 3 a.m. constrains my freedom to sleep, right? So what are we going to do about that? Well, one solution is simply to segregate your home from my home and say, you live way over there, I live way over here. Okay, you party till 3 a.m., I don't care. That is, in a way, the idea of segregation, functional segregation. If you have conflicts, the industrial heart of the cities, and there's pollution and so on, then you pull the city apart into pieces. And that's really the genesis of sprawl. The whole idea of sprawl is that you simply segregate. But another design strategy is to mediate with adaptive structures. So for example, I might have a soundproof glass, or I might have a fence that has soundproof qualities or so forth. And now we've separated from one another. We've separated the potential conflict. from one another, and we can live very closely in proximity because we have this adaptive structure. And not only that, we have a connection to one another as well through the public spaces, through this system of room-like spaces going from my most private to the most public realm and then back to your most private realm. We are now connected to each other through the public space. Again, this is very, very important when we think about what cities are and why they have the structure that they have of public and private spaces. So this is a room-like system of spaces from the most public to the most private, and they're connected in various ways. And I'll give you another more concrete example. This is a street around the corner from where I used to live in London. And you can see there's lots of retail and residential and outdoor garden spaces and so on. And there are also many different connections between those spaces. There's obviously windows and doors, but there's also hedges and shrubs and so on. And there are ways that you can move between the spaces, or you can see between the spaces, or you can hear but not see, or you can see but not hear if it's the glass and so forth. And if you map those all out, all the different places, the room-like places that people can be and see and hear and move, it's a dizzying web, a web network of places. I call it a place network. And this is what's going on in the most exciting, most dynamic cities, is that these structures are all around us and they're sort of self-organizing from the most private space to the most public space. And we ourselves are controlling how connected those spaces are with windows and doors and gates out in the public realm and, you know, going out to the street and so forth. And then we're also able to open a door, close a window, draw a blind, but also remodel and change our structures slowly over time and transform that environment, modifying this place network in small and large ways. And this is an affordance that is very, very important in terms of what we can do in our environments to make ourselves more comfortable and more healthy. And it's a key property of cities, I would argue. And so this self-organization transforms these place networks over time. I went back to the same place after 5 years, and you can see not only new businesses and new paint and signage and so on, but also new definitions of these place networks, these urban places. There are new fences, there's new stoops, new planters defining a stoop there. The sidewalk cafe is gone. I don't know, maybe it's the time of year or something, but they're gradually transforming over 5 years. And cities transform in much larger degrees over much longer spans of time. So for example, in Venice, over 100 years or so, you have the sort of boring cadastral plan on the left that transforms into this rich tapestry of spaces that are interconnected and mediated, the conflicts between them and so on. And this is all self-organizing. People are making these little adaptations and going to the Doge for permission to build something and so on, producing this incredible rich city that we all know and love today. And a lot of work has been done on this. This is a paper by Mustafa Ben Hamouche showing that local people making agreements can sometimes transform and create these marvelous sort of evolutionary structures over time that give cities their quality, their richness, their adaptivity to human need and human delight. And you can see, for example, in Pisa, this idea of the place networks that form and so on. You'll see it everywhere you go, really, if you think about it this way. However, here we are in the modern world, right? And the idea of growth is something that is really pathological. If we know that something is going to be developed, we're going to be afraid of it because we've seen it happen before, right? And it's been something that has been horrible, undesirable. And so that's the idea that a lot of people have of growth. But after all, this is growth too, right? This is a stepwise transformation of the structures in a natural environment that create a very beautiful structure as a result. So here's stepwise growth according to rules and processes that produces very ugly, disordered, unsustainable environments, segregated use zoning and remote design processes and bank lending rules, traffic engineering and so forth. But here's another form of stepwise growth according to rules and processes, and it uses genetic algorithms and chemical control signals and stepwise transformation of compounding forms and differentiation and so forth. And here's another form of stepwise growth according to rules and processes, shared types and patterns, shared rules, economic incentives and adaptive agents and people working locally to transform their own environments in a more agile kind of way. And Christoph Alexander has described that, actually described Venice in particular and how it is transformed over about a century or so, and how natural environments do that as well. he has described in his great masterwork, The Nature of Order, how these processes work in the natural world and how they tend to produce characteristic geometry, the different levels of scale, the strong centers, the boundaries, alternating repetition, positive space, and so on. And this is just one example of a famous experiment by Harold Edgerton, the milk drop experiment, where he, what's called symmetry breaking, he takes a drop of milk and shatters it, but it doesn't result in disorder, it results in a new order, new forms of order with all these geometric properties. And Alexander says that this is going on all the time in the natural world and in the world of human traditions, these transformations that produce these rich geometric properties that we know and love, these rich symmetries. And this happens also in traditional architecture, the levels of scale, the boundaries, the strong centers, the local symmetries, and so forth, alternating repetition, boundaries, and so on. And this is really related to the work that he has done on patterns and pattern languages. Some of you may have heard this term before, the book, A Pattern Language, which is very famous, looking at how design elements can be interconnected into a more holistic web network, consistent with what we've been talking about. And that technology actually produced Wiki, as in Wikipedia, directly, as my friend Ward Cunningham has pointed out. Also, it has led to design patterns and software, to Agile, to Scrum, and so forth. This is not very well known, but there's a huge software world and in other fields of design outside of architecture. And as I mentioned, in Wiki and in many games, that has resulted directly from Alexander's work on patterns and directly from all the things that we're talking about in terms of interconnected web networks. This is all related. So our team, working with UN Habitat and other partners, has developed a new pattern language, looking at the new urban agenda, really, and how to transform that, how to translate that into a new set of patterns that's also online in this Wiki. We launched this at the World Urban Forum last year. There's a companion Wiki version that you can go on to npl.wiki and play with, and that you're welcome to try that. It's a kind of repository that means that people can add patterns, they can edit the patterns, they can adapt patterns to their own local needs, they can share them. The patterns can do new things like make numeric calculations or make field measurements or function as apps or so on. The collections are federated, which means they can be shared among different communities and so forth. Just go onto npl.wiki and you can see that in action. Okay, my final section here. I've been working with my friend Nico Salingeros on symmetry, and this is in a deep sense of the word symmetry in the mathematical sense. It's very related to everything else we've been talking about here today, web networks and patterns of connection, patterns of relationship. And this is a paper that I recently wrote about the impacts of symmetry on human well-being. And this is really an exciting new research agenda, I think. Nikos and I wrote a blog post in the Planner's Journal, Planetizen, showing that there may be something called a symmetry deficit disorder produced by new architecture today, by the sculptural architecture that we've been talking about, that is quite damaging to human health and well-being. And this would be a pretty clear form of malpractice if this can be shown, as we think it can be. And so again, this is a form of symmetry that's not just the reflectional or mirror symmetry that most people think of. There's also rotational symmetry, there's translational symmetry, there's scaling symmetry, many other kinds as well. And there are very sophisticated discussions of symmetry in architectural history by Alberti, Vitruvius, and many other people. And it's not just mirror symmetry as most architects think of today, quite wrongly. And there are also compound symmetries. For example, you all know how beautiful the pattern of a kaleidoscope can be. Fractal patterns, the patterns in nature that are beautiful and fractal, and combine these scaling symmetries with mirror symmetries, with translational symmetries, and many other kinds. And in human architectures as well, and in the human body, not only combined symmetries, but what we call deep symmetries that are interrelated with each other and with ourselves as viewers. You know, when we look at a beautiful human body, we feel a symmetry between ourselves and that structure, and landscapes and beautiful buildings and so on, that often combine many different forms of symmetry. And there's pretty strong evidence that this is closely related to the idea of sustainability, because the deep symmetries create the kind of interrelationship that creates value and creates desirability to continue a structure For example, the Pantheon in Rome that is 1900 years old, 19 centuries. Do we think that the building on the right, which is really a pretty naked building that has just been sort of shrubbed up with vegetation, is that going to last 19 centuries? Or is it going to be torn down in about 30 years because it's the latest fashionable thing? And in 30 years, it won't be the latest fashionable thing. This is a very, very important critique of sustainability that I think we all have to recognize today. And again, there's evidence emerging from neuroscience that this idea of beauty that we experience, whether you can talk about it as an objective phenomenon, is certainly an objective experience in human beings. And it relates to definable structural characteristic that we can describe in neuroscience. Samir Zeki, a neurobiologist, has done that. And he has noted that this is not a luxury, but an essential ingredient in, as he put it, nourishing the emotional brain. So this is critical for human health and well-being. And so this is the note that I think we need to conclude on, that this is not just about old-fashioned buildings and about, oh, well, you're quaint and we're modern. Quite the opposite, actually. This is at the forefront of scientific understanding of what matters in our environments for sustainability, for health, for well-being, for the new urban agenda. These characteristics, these properties that are so very important for human health and well-being. And so, yes, it is a challenge to architecture and urban design, and I think a very profound challenge that has not been met squarely, not been faced up to. And it means that architecture and urbanism need to embrace human life and human connection, to shift from objects to places, to embrace the many new tools and strategies that are emerging as a result of this wonderful period in history when these are coming out of the sciences, out of other fields besides architecture. So architects need to get out of their silos and begin working with these other disciplines and begin critiquing themselves, begin understanding that while there's still a central place for expressive art and form, its role is not to depart from the world of everyday life, but to enrich it and to ennoble it and to illuminate the meaning of our world and to make our world a more profound place. Thank you all.
Michael, thank you for this rich lecture that you have given us about so many important knowledges that we have to think of and develop. And I'm so fond of the evolutionary aspect and the biological and the neurobiological aspects physician, and that the creativity, the fundamental creativity that we find in nature that you have told us so rich now, and how it applies on architecture. So I do feel very enriched by this lovely presentation.
Thank you. Well, I thought you would appreciate it in particular because of your background as a physician and the things that we've talked about before.
Yes.
And your work looking at, for example, the Million Homes program and yes. You know, why that has gone awry and so on. And yes, this is very important, I think.
Yes. Now I let the Zoom floor for all participants to ask and discuss with Michael, please.
I would like to have a little more Stockholm in it, and that is private and vad heter det, offentlig,
official.
Areas. The most important in Stockholm and many other cities in Sweden, that is, in the blocks, the gardens inside the blocks, they are sort of a half semi-private area that could be really something very, very socially attractive and important thing. Now, in this, when you want to build everything in the middle of the cities, they build in these gardens and destroy it. Mm-hmm. And that goes very, it's very fast process now. That is one thing that I maybe you could add in the next time. This is a semi-private thing, and they could be made better than they are today. But you must not, absolutely not, build in them. And the other thing is to make this fantastic presentation, more Swedish, and that is that acceptera, you know, the Swedish Bible for modernists, accept, and that is with this sign very much so. It's worse in this way, better than Corbusier. It's terrible that such a thing can be written. And I would also like to give a little more open hint to the other movements in the early 20th century. Communism and fascism and so on, the dictatorial ideas.
Right. So I just respond to a couple of your points. One of them is I don't want to be too arrogant as a non-Swede talking too much about the Sweden context, but of course there's a lot that's very relevant there, and I certainly could talk about that. I could talk about, for example, the tendency in many cities today, including in Stockholm, to take a silver bullet approach or a one size fits all approach. And for example, the idea of density and that, okay, well, we just need density. So let's just bring in, you know, monolithic buildings with lots and lots of residential units in them. And if we have these lovely courtyard spaces, those are luxuries and we can't afford them. Let's just bulldoze them and replace them with buildings. That is a mistake. It's not just an unfortunate thing, an unfortunate loss for those who care about those spaces. It's actually a mistake because from a design practitioner point of view, because it fails to recognize that you need, that density is not one thing. It's a pattern, right? It's a pattern of open and closed and high and low. And in order to live in a building with many other people, you also need outdoor space that's open very close by, or else you're not going to feel well. You're not going to have what you need as a human being. So all of those things are very, very important from a, you know, from a human point of view. And then the other point is just that I think what is happening in the profession in many ways is a kind of doubling down, because the economic forces are still very much allowing architects to continue to function in this sort of starkitecture mode. And there are a lot of sort of reinforcing ideologies. And this also does go back to your point about ideology. There is a lot of ideology involved in this, but it's not, I wouldn't say it's ideology that is coherent in any sense. For example, Le Corbusier and the his two colleagues who were perhaps most influential, Mies and Gropius, were very happy to collaborate with the Nazis. Le Corbusier certainly was, but also happy to collaborate with Stalin, happy to collaborate with, you know, the American capitalists, and so on and so forth. So at the end of the day, they were not dedicated to an ideology. They were using ideology in the same way that they were using visual metaphors, you know, as a kind of product packaging again. And this is still going on today, I think, in many ways. And so I think what we still have to do is mount a larger challenge to the profession from other disciplines who can be empowered to speak up and not be intimidated by this sort of empire's new clothes syndrome, like, shut up, little boy, you don't know, you're not an expert like we are. Well, excuse me, you're an expert at a corrupt enterprise and you need to be challenged, because there are people within that enterprise who are pointing this all out, and it's been well documented in research. So this is, you know, this is not an easy way to conduct reform. But it's a necessary way. And there are people who have been doing it for many years now, going back to Jane Jacobs, Christopher Alexander, and others. And I think we just have to continue that effort and continue to get to a deeper understanding of the dynamics and not sort of play into the framing. I'll close on one other point, this idea of framing, which is, you know, comes from environmental psychology, social psychology, George Lakoff and others, that if you create a frame, a way of thinking about a topic, and then you get other people to sort of step into that frame, then it just reinforces that frame. So for example, you guys who like traditional architecture, you're just a bunch of old fuddy-duddies, you know, and you're not really with it. You're not modern, you're not cutting edge. So that's the frame. And so if you step outside of that frame and say, excuse me, we have a physician who's done research on the Million Homes program and backed it up with citations. We have a PhD in architecture. We have, you know, people who are not just simply, you know, in this mythological frame that you have created. We are stepping outside of that. And I think you all have done, as I see it, you've done a very good job of sort of sidestepping a lot of these stereotypical myths and framing devices and you know, created greater understanding, greater points of agreement for a broader community of people. And I think that's what we need to do, frankly.
Yes, I presume you have a lot of questions.
Well, it's quite often the case that I cover so many topics in my talks, and Peter knows this, and he sometimes tells me that I should simplify them, but I also find it a journey for myself to explore these topics, so I really enjoy that. And often people, there's so many different topics covered that it's a little overwhelming to grab onto one point and cover it, because they're all, you know, fairly, I've talked about a lot of different disciplines and you know, none of us is a sociologist, I don't think, none of us is a mathematician and so on. So it's perhaps a bit awkward trying to respond to any of these points in any detail.
But we agree with you, so what do we say?
Well, that's the other problem, is that there's not much to argue about, is there?
Exactly.
Yes. Michael, it's a lot of work that has been done, that has to be done, and it's a great burden. And as you mentioned, in Stockholm, and Ulf also mentioned it, we are in a very destructive period. Yeah. The green areas is being devastated by new houses, and boxes are being destroyed and things like that. I wish we could have further contact with you. And I know you have a seat at Kungliga Tekniska Högskolan.
Yeah. Well, we have our center. I'm going to be there as a guest researcher through September, and then I hope I will continue to be in Stockholm periodically with Peter and Tigran Haas, who's there at KTH, and others, and continuing to join you all in various events. I think we all have, you know, this is a case in many times in history where one has to be part of a struggle, and it may be very intimidating. But it doesn't mean it isn't very, very important for us to redouble our efforts and to bring all the resources to bear.
Can also be very stimulating. As you know, we all that has been listening to your wonderful speech today, we are part of Blasieholmens Vänner, and it's a very broad organization with thousands of people that are very disturbed of what's happening to our beautiful town.
Right.
And I know all of them are interested in the thoughts, the knowledge, the experience that you are willing to share. And that's wonderful. And I do hope that we will have several occasions when you come to Sweden in September and so on.
Well, I hope so too. And let me just say that what I hope that my work can do, and my colleagues' work, Nikos and others, is to give all of the people who recognize this problem not only the ammunition to, you know, continue the struggle, but the confidence to believe that, you know, I'm not just a little boy, the emperor really is naked.
Justin wanted to say something, didn't
you? Justin, please.
Yes, I arrived a little too late to this meeting. I apologize for that. But I think one interesting issue is that it's a tremendous gap between the today's rationalism with huge blocks and between that and what we see in photos and what we experience in surroundings where we find this type of life possibilities, as Mr. Mehaffy has showed us. And I think it's a matter of psychology, how to make this gap be at first a little smaller, because the people working with these rationalistic buildings, They can't imagine how to create what we have seen now. And I think that's a big question, how to present your ideas.
I think that's very important. And I think, you know, there's a huge education role here, not only education of students. And Nikos, for example, is teaching an architecture class at the University of Texas. And I've taught a number of architecture classes as well. And so we're sort of, you know, we're countercultural in the way that a lot of architecture is taught today. And that's very important to say, no, there is another way of looking at this, but also educating the public at large to present, as you say, Kirsten, the evidence about what really happens as opposed to what the images are and what the claims are, because they're always sort of moving along to the next thing. No, we don't do that anymore. We do this new exciting thing. But wait a minute, what did we learn from what you did before? And why is it actually more of the same, what you're proposing? So it's a public education process as much as anything.
I have to say hello.
Metta, raise your
hand first. Can't it be that many architects also are afraid of stepping outside the framework to make something different? They think the colleagues won't accept them any longer, and so on.
Absolutely. You know, if the in the old the emperor's new clothes, you know, a lot of the people in the story knew that the emperor was naked. They could see that, but they were afraid to say that, right? So there's this sense among many people in architecture that if they had the courage to not feel that they were going to be attacked, they might speak out and they might change their practices. But this goes all the way back to school and to what I've seen, for example, in the crit, you know, where the students put up their drawings, and the more sort of strange and weird and attention getting designs are the ones that get praised. And the designs that look like some other building, even if they're quite innovative in the details, but the overall maybe looks like, they get attacked for being too, you know, traditional or pedestrian or you know, boring or something like that. So this goes back to the schools as well.
Then it's Kerstin's and then Ulf.
I feel afraid.
Kerstin Barup, sorry.
Oh, sorry.
You raised your hand, didn't you?
No, well, I didn't, but I can maybe I can just add that I think the teachers at the schools of architecture are all generation.
Lecture that you have given us about so many important knowledges that we have to think of and develop, and I so fond of the evolutionary aspect. and the biological and the neurobiological aspects as physician, and that the creativity, the fundamental creativity that we find in nature that you have told us so rich now, and how it applies on architecture. So I do feel very enriched by this lovely presentation.
Thank you. Well, I thought you would appreciate it in particular because of your background as a physician and the things that we've talked about before.
Yes.
And your work looking at, for example, the Million Homes program and yes. You know, why that has gone awry and so on. And yes, this is very important, I think.
Yes. Now I let the Zoom floor for all participants to ask and discuss with Michael, please.
I would like to have a little more Stockholm in it, and that is private and vad heter det, offentlig?
Official.
Areas. The most important in Stockholm and many other cities in Sweden, that is in the blocks, the gardens inside the blocks. They are sort of a half semi-private area that could be really something very, very socially attractive and important thing. Now, in this, when you want to build everything in the middle of the cities, they build in these gardens and destroy it. Mm-hmm. And that goes very, it's very fast process now. That is one thing that I maybe you could add in the next time. This is a semi-private thing, and they could be made better than they are today, but you must not, absolutely not build in them. And the other thing is to make this fantastic presentation more Swedish, and that is that acceptera, you know, the Swedish Bible for modernists, accept, and that is with this sign very much so. It's worse in this way, better than Corbusier. It's terrible that such a thing can be written. And I would also like to give a little more open hint to the other movements in the early 20th century. Communism and fascism and so on, the dictatorial ideas.
Right. So I just respond to a couple of your points. One of them is I don't want to be too arrogant as a non-Swede talking too much about the Sweden context, but of course there's a lot that's very relevant there, and I certainly could talk about that. I could talk about, for example, the tendency in many cities today, including in Stockholm, to take a silver bullet approach or a one size fits all approach. And for example, the idea of density and that, okay, well, we just need density. So let's just bring in, you know, monolithic buildings with lots and lots of residential units in them. And if we have these lovely courtyard spaces, those are luxuries and we can't afford them. Let's just bulldoze them and replace them with buildings. That is a mistake. It's not just an unfortunate thing, an unfortunate loss for those who care about those spaces. It's actually a mistake because from a design practitioner point of view, because it fails to recognize that you need, that density is not one thing. It's a pattern, right? It's a pattern of open and closed and high and low. And in order to live in a building with many other people, you also need outdoor space that's open very close by, or else you're not going to feel well. You're not going to have what you need as a human being. So all of those things are very, very important from a human point of view. And then the other point is just that I think what is happening in the profession in many ways is a kind of doubling down. because the economic forces are still very much allowing architects to continue to function in this sort of starkitecture mode. And there are a lot of sort of reinforcing ideologies. And this also does go back to your point about ideology. There is a lot of ideology involved in this, but it's not, I wouldn't say it's ideology that is coherent in any sense. For example, Le Corbusier and his two colleagues who were perhaps most influential, Mies and Gropius, were very happy to collaborate with the Nazis, like Le Corbusier certainly was, but also happy to collaborate with Stalin, happy to collaborate with, you know, the American capitalists, and so on and so forth. So at the end of the day, they were not dedicated to an ideology. They were using ideology in the same way that they were using visual metaphors, you know, as a kind of product packaging again. And this is still going on today, I think, in many ways. And so I think what we still have to do is mount a larger challenge to the profession from other disciplines who can be empowered to speak up and not be intimidated by this sort of empire's new clothes syndrome, like, shut up, little boy, you don't know, you're not an expert like we are. Well, excuse me, you're an expert at a corrupt enterprise, and you need to be challenged because there are people within that enterprise who are pointing this all out, and it's been well documented in research. So this is, you know, this is not an easy way to conduct reform, but it's a necessary way, and there are people who have been doing it for many years now, going back to Jane Jacobs, Christopher Alexander, and others. And I think we just have to continue that effort and continue to get to a deeper understanding of the dynamics and not sort of play into the framing. I'll close on one other point, this idea of framing, which is, you know, comes from environmental psychology, social psychology, George Lakoff and others, that if you create a frame, a way of thinking about a topic, and then you get other people to sort of step into that frame, then it just reinforces that frame. So for example, you guys who like traditional architecture, you're just a bunch of old fuddy-duddies, you know, and you're not really with it. You're not modern, you're not cutting edge. So that's the frame. And so if you step outside of that frame and say, excuse me, we have a physician who's done research on the Million Homes Program, and backed it up with citations. We have a PhD in architecture. We have, you know, people who are not just simply, you know, in this mythological frame that you have created. We are stepping outside of that. And I think you all have done, as I see it, you've done a very good job of sort of sidestepping a lot of these stereotypical myths and framing devices, and you know, created greater understanding, greater points of agreement for a broader community of people. And I think that's what we need to do, frankly.
Yes. I presume you have a lot of questions.
Well, it's quite often the case that I cover so many topics in my talks, and Peter knows this, and he sometimes tells me that I should simplify them, but I also find it a journey for myself to explore these topics, so I really enjoy that. And often people, there's so many different topics covered that it's a little overwhelming to grab onto one point and cover it, because they're all, you know, fairly... I've talked about a lot of different disciplines, and you know, none of us is a sociologist, I don't think. None of us is a mathematician, and so on. So it's perhaps a bit awkward trying to respond to any of these points in any detail.
But we agree with you, so what do we say?
Well, that's the other problem, is that there's not much to argue about, is there?
Exactly.
Yes. Michael, it's a lot of work that has been done, that has to be done, and it's a great burden. And as you mentioned, in Stockholm, and Ulf also mentioned it, we are in a very destructive period. The green areas is being devastated by new houses, and boxes are being destroyed, and things like that. I wish we could have further contact with you. And I know you have a seat at Kungliga Tekniska Högskolan.
Yeah. Well, we have our center. I'm going to be there as a guest researcher through September. And then I hope I will continue to be in Stockholm periodically with Peter and Tigran Haas, who's there at KTH, and others, and continuing to, join you all in various events. I think we all have, this is a case in many times in history where one has to be part of a struggle. And it may be very intimidating, but it doesn't mean it isn't very, very important for us to redouble our efforts and to bring all the resources to bear.
Can also be very stimulating. As you know, we all that has been listening to your wonderful speech today, we are part of Blasieholmens Vänner, and it's a very broad organization with thousands of people that are very disturbed of what's happening to our beautiful town.
Right.
And I know all of them are interested in the thoughts, the knowledge, the experience that you are willing to share, and that's wonderful. And I do hope that we will have several occasions when you come to Sweden in September and so on.
Well, I hope so too. And let me just say that what I hope that my work can do, and my colleagues' work, Nikos and others, is to give all of the people who recognize this problem not only the ammunition to continue the struggle, but the confidence to believe that, I'm not just a little boy, the emperor really is naked.
Justin wanted to say something, didn't
you? Justin, please.
Yes, I arrived a little too late to this meeting. I apologize for that. But I think one interesting issue is that it's a tremendous gap between the today's rationalism with huge blocks and between that and what we see in photos and what we experience in surroundings where we find this type of life possibilities, as Mr. Mehaffy has showed us. And I think it's a matter of psychology, how to make this gap be at first a little smaller, because the people working with these rationalistic buildings, they can't imagine how to create what we have seen now. And I think that's a big question, how to present your ideas.
I think that's very important. And I think, there's a huge education role here, not only education of students. And Nikos, for example, is teaching an architecture class at the University of Texas. And I've taught a number of architecture classes as well. And so we're sort of, we're countercultural in the way that a lot of architecture is taught today. And that's very important to say, no, there is another way of looking at this, but also educating the public at large to present, as you say, Kirsten, the evidence about what really happens as opposed to what the images are and what the claims are, because they're always sort of moving along to the next thing. No, we don't do that anymore. We do this new exciting thing. but wait a minute, what did we learn from what you did before? And why is it actually more of the same, what you're proposing? So it's a public education process as much as anything.
I have to say hello.
Metta,
raise your hand first. No, can't it be that many architects also are afraid of stepping outside the framework to make something different? They right. think the colleagues won't accept them any longer, and so on.
Absolutely. You know, if they, in the old, the emperor's new clothes, you know, a lot of the people in the story knew that the emperor was naked. They could see that, but they were afraid to say that, right? So there's this sense among many people in architecture that if they had the courage to not feel that they were going to be attacked, they might speak out and they might change their practices. But this goes all the way back to school and to what I've seen, for example, in the crit, you know, where the students put up their drawings, and the more sort of strange and weird and attention getting designs are the ones that get praised. And the designs that look like some other building, even if they're quite innovative in the details, but the overall maybe looks like, they get attacked for being too, you know, traditional or pedestrian or you know, boring or something like that. So this goes back to the schools as well. Mm-hmm.
Then it's Kerstin's and then Ulf.
I feel afraid.
Kerstin Barup, sorry.
Oh, sorry.
You raised your hand, didn't you?
No, well, I didn't, but I can, maybe I can just add that I think the teachers at the schools of architecture are all kind of generation who were taught as modernists, and that is kind of a problem. I think there is a change of generations now, and I think that the students of architecture are quite interested in thinking new. They're not stubborn, they are really open-minded, to my opinion. But as you say, Michael, if they are criticized for everything they do except what is accepted modernism, of course that's a problem. But I know, because I think some teachers are very self-convinced about what's good, and so the students kind of adopt to that. So if they want to get a pass, they do what they are taught, and they tell sometimes people like myself, who is not so difficult to talk to, I hope, and they don't really dare to say to those star architects what they think, but they are really clever, and I think it's quite creative to do something at school and then think about it wasn't so good, but it was giving me credits, I got the pass, so now that was interesting, let's do something else. I think there is something going on, but it takes a lot of time because people are stopping them. It's like a child. They are trying to walk, and if you stop them, they fall now and then. But you can't stop a child from walking. It just could take a little bit more time if they are stopped now and then. Hmm.
I agree, and I think that's very important. You know, it's easy to sort of imagine things as being black and white on whatever level you're thinking about that. You know, the schools are terrible and there's nothing interesting going on there and so on and so forth. And that's not true. There are very interesting things that are sort of bubbling up and students who are doing interesting things. It's really just that there's a sort of a prevailing paradigm that is an old paradigm in many ways, and it is being propelled and sustained by old forces, economic forces, forces of fashion and so on and so forth. And the more we can challenge that, and the more we can, you know, speak truth to power, as they say, the more we can begin to break open and have more opportunities for things to happen in the schools and build on the things that already are happening. I know you're absolutely right. I certainly found that in my career as well, that there are interesting things going on.
And time has passed, but I have one last question. It's maybe someone else. You are director of the future of places research network.
Right.
So could you just say a few words about that? It sounds so interesting. And you have yes.
Right, this is a collaboration with my friend, Peter Elmland. It grew out of our work with UN Habitat and with what's called the Future of Places partnership with UN Habitat and Project for Public Spaces, where we created some language that went into the new urban agenda about public space specifically. And then we continued to partner with them. We created the center at KTH, which is a 5-year project to work with UN Habitat on implementation. And then parallel to that is the Future of Places Research Network, which is an independent but parallel collaboration of not only myself and Peter and Tigran, but a network of other researchers, I think about 50 people all told, all over, especially the Europe and the United States, but many other countries as well. And they're all to one degree or another working along these lines. So I believe very much in you know, collaboration with many different groups, many different researchers, many different activists such as yourselves, and creating larger federations, if you will, for this movement, this larger movement of shifting from objects to places and focusing upon human well-being in the built environment, as opposed to the destructive patterns that we all recognize are still going on and have to stop. They will stop in one way or another. They'll either stop catastrophically because we'll hit a wall and the things will become very very destructive for everybody, or we will begin to make these reforms on our own as professionals and as activists and as business people and citizens. And that's what that's the choice I prefer.
Thank you. Now it's time for us to stop. Do anyone has a last question? I will have a little room for that. No, I think it's fine like that. Michael, a very warm thanking for a wonderful presentation. And I see that everyone has learned a lot. And there are so many in Stockholm and Sweden that needs to and wants to learn about things that you have taught us about. And once again, I hope we will have more times further to meet. So, Michael, have a good day, and to the rest of us, have a nice evening. Bye-bye.
Bye.